pandemic of violence floods the streets of major cities as cases of the media-dubbed murder virus, MV20, soar, causing those infected to go on killing sprees. Caught in the middle, police detective Angela Miller finds her only trustworthy ally in the self-proclaimed psychic PI, Gerald Henry. As the two try to navigate the violence, they are drawn into New Age guru Abramelin Harvest's plot to heal the planet. Harvest's missive?
The world is sick, and humanity is the infection.
The cure? Murder. From the twisted mind of Shawn C. Baker, author of A Collection of Desires and Shadowplay Book 1, Kim and Jesse, comes his most vicious novel yet, Murder Virus. Available where books are sold.
Yeah, it'll be up there.
Hello.
Yeah. Hey.
Hi. Good evening.
Good morning, Mike. How you doing,
good
buddy?
Good morning. What are you drinking, Uncle Hank?
It is 1800 tequila.
We are now live, just so everybody
we're live.
Knows.
Hey, hey, America.
You know, I've been alive for a while.
So,
just saying.
Everybody, welcome to Drinking with Comics. So, I'm Sean. Mike Wellman, aka Mike Wallman, is here. And then we have Hank Sparrow and Karen Kunawicz. And we're going to talk about so much stuff. So first and foremost, Trese, am I saying that right? Because I mispronounce everything. Okay. That premieres.
Kunawicz.
That's Kunawicz. Fine. Good.
Trese releases on June 11th on Netflix. And it is an adaptation of a famed.
Adaptation.
Adaptation, I'll say it correctly. You're gonna be fucking grammar police today.
it's gonna be that kind of show. Okay.
I guess so, Hank. So that premieres next week. It's an adaptation of a popular comic or graphic novel in the Philippines.
Apparently, the train broke down over the Kuala Lumpur Bridge. Service crew found it like this. Lots of blood, no bodies, and a pile of missing persons reports.
Tabi tabi po.
Greetings, young Trese.
Good evening, Nuno.
There was a time when magic in the world was a natural part of life. That age has passed. People fear what they don't understand. That's why our family has always been the bridge between mankind and the supernatural.
What the hell are we dealing with?
A lot of tribes are on edge, making bad deals with badder folk.
That balance you and your father have tried so desperately to maintain is at its end. You're treading on very thin ice, little Trese.
Can't be too sure about the underworld these days.
Please help me.
You are the Babaylan Mandarima, healer and warrior.
Ibunyan ang nakatago.
You were born ready.
Hank, the creature is a Chana.
Do you hear it calling for me?
You want my advice? Keep your heads down.
They're coming for revenge.
If the Lakan gets in the way, kill her.
There's something bigger going on here. The tribes need to be united.
Well, the tempest is brewing, and there are liars amongst your allies.
Come on, boys.
Let's put an end to this.
I don't know, where do we start? The trailer looks amazing. I didn't know anything about this until Mike told me about it, sends me the trailer. I'm like, what is this? It looks great. He's like, oh, you know, Uncle Hank. And I had no idea who you were. So I'm like, wait, I thought it was Uncle Dick. I thought you were talking about your uncle. And I'm like,
no,
wait, he's in
it.
So he explained, obviously. And Karen, I mean, you were at a Drinking with Comics.
Yes.
Five years ago? I was
discussing Filipino
three
Thor.
4 years ago.
Yes. That, yes.
Victor, Vince, Hank, if you remember, it's Victor Magtanggol.
How could I forget? That was a train wreck. What not was? All the stuff that comes out of the Philippines is a train wreck, but this particular one was just like,
What's happening? What is
going on? No!
Yeah. What do you, one of our episodes or what?
Yes, we were.
Do you not remember that she was?
No, Mike, there's another show. They're stealing your thunder, man. They call themselves Drinking with Comics too.
It's hosted by us, but you. No.
Yeah, I don't remember any train wrecks.
No. No, your show isn't a train wreck.
Oh, our show has been a train wreck several times, sir.
Despite what they have said. No, I was talking about the Filipino. They tried to do like a weird Thor live action, but not, well, they based it on Thor, but not Thor.
Thor, but not Thor.
Thor, but not Thor.
I think you know about this. Yeah. It was on Drinking.
Yeah, I want to see that. I need to see that.
Anyway, it was pretty bad. It was pretty bad. The show was pretty bad.
Bad sometimes is good.
Well, no, they were like, this one is like cringy bad, you know?
What was it called again?
Victor Magtanggol.
Okay.
So yeah. I think it was a Victor Defender. Would it be that? Would
Magtanggol,
that be the English?
It would be, yeah, translated into English would be like Defender or Protector. Okay. Yeah.
Maybe we can find the trailer and I might put it in.
I might still have some images left over from the last episode. I'm sure I probably
talked about it on the show?
Yeah.
Yes. I don't think Mike can remember, but yes, we did.
I mean, I only vaguely remember.
Can.
But,
yeah. What's everybody drinking tonight? I'm drinking.
You can check it. I think it's on YouTube.
It is.
I'm drinking Mike's Hard Lemonade.
Oh, wow.
Which, coffee ironically, or whatever, store colors.
Oh, yeah. That's why you bought that. I was going to say, why are you
drinking? It is my signature beverage when I'm not drinking red wine.
Really?
Is there?
Yeah.
Man,
why wouldn't it be?
Because it's Mike's Hard Lemonade. I don't know. It just
it's got my name on it. It's black and yellow.
Oh, okay. All right.
If you want to think about me, drink a Mike's Hard Lemonade.
Does Mike's Hard Lemonade have any alcohol? Or is that a
barely
8%?
Okay.
Yeah, 8%.
Well, you know what? I would buy it. Anything that says Mike's Hard Blank, I would buy it.
You got a fan, Mike.
I would buy one for you if you were here, sir.
I actually discovered through friends who are also fans of the show, our friends Maddie and Kenta, they introduced me to a brewery from Anaheim called Unsung, and all of their beers are based on original comic characters that they created for the beers. And so this is the Lumino. And let's see if I can never do this.
I just see your hand. Oh, there it is.
There we go. So this is a Mexican style lager, and it's the character Lumino. He was a pitcher that then he can, based on like an accident, can hurl fiery baseballs at things. So
good for him.
It's a pretty good lager. I wanted something kind of light, and you know, there you go.
That's a cool concept.
And what about you, Miss Karen? What are you drinking?
Coffee. I can get some liquor.
No, you're fine.
You don't have to. It was funny because I was rereading Trese, and we'll get to that in a minute. But her boys, like,
yeah,
I don't know,
the Kumbal,
for some reason that character started reminding
the
me
twins,
so much of you.
Yes,
and she's like, boys, go get a drink,
and then
go get me an
espresso.
Yeah, and bring me. And she never gets that espresso either. I'm pretty sure. I think she brings it up later on.
Their drink. And then the punchline at the end of episode two is like, where's my espresso?
Yeah. And I think she mentions it in the next one too, if I'm not mistaken, where I never got that.
Oh,
espresso.
Really?
I think so. I could be confusing it because I read it all in one shot. So
yeah, yeah. I remember when we were in the Philippines, me and Raph, I guess me and Raph were kind of bossy boys.
What?
Oh, are you What's saying how they refer to her as bossing, right? Is that how that's
bossing,
said?
Bossing, yes, yes.
Bossing's boys. And so we're like at some hotel before a convention and we're like having wine and she orders like a dark chocolate, you know, like not alcohol, like she's just having a dark chocolate. And it's like, oh, wow, this reminds me so much of Karen. Because here we are like, you know, these like call my boys on you. Don't make me call my boys on you.
Right,
you know?
Right. So you basically became Karen. So see, like you guys could have like totally cosplayed that. You and Raph is the Kambal and Karen is bossing.
Well, next time we're there, yes.
Okay, I think Karen could have... Go ahead, Karen.
I cannot bossing Mike. He is... When he's out of control, he's out of control. There's no... You can't.
I know.
You can't. It's not possible.
So
I wish, but... It's not. You cannot reel him in. There's a certain point where the balloon just flies.
What a wonderful analogy.
And you can't,
the balloon.
You can't reel it back in. Oh, can't hold it back in.
That's why they call it cosplay.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's talk about... First of all, shout out to Anthony behind you, Mike. I think
hey,
I
see him. What's up?
How you doing, buddy? Cool.
So
it was just his birthday the other day.
Oh, happy birthday.
Birthday.
Happy birthday, man.
So Mike did give me, or he sold me, which I was happy to pay for it, the first volume of the American translated Trese, which is published by Ablaze.
Ablaze.
Although it's always been in English.
Okay, okay.
Hank, it's always been in English, right?
Yes,
with a few like phrases in Tagalog, but mostly in English. Yeah. Mike has most of the Trese.
I'm missing volume three.
There, you're missing volume three.
So what is out here to, like, I guess I'm realizing now that I could have just tracked down and bought all three volumes of the original. I was assuming because it was being republished here that it had been translated, but that's not the case.
Can't get it here, dude. Only volume one.
And it's updated. It's updated art.
Oh, okay. Okay. That's cool.
Different from the, the artist, Kajo, wanted to improve upon it. And, he just loves to draw. He's nonstop. I mean, Hank and I interviewed Kajo once, and in the middle of the interview, he's drawing, and like we don't know what he's drawing. He's just drawing, and he's taking one, and he's, you know, throwing paper left and right, and then at the end of it,
it was a long interview though. It was over an hour, right? We had a lot of stuff to talk about. Yeah, but at the end of the interview,
he's very quiet and. He's just talking and talking. And at the end of the whole interview, he sits on the floor and lays out 9 pieces of paper. And he draws like a portrait of Trese on the 9 pieces of
paper. Oh, wow.
Each piece of paper was yay big, right? So you put 9 of those together. It was like, it was huge.
Yeah.
Wow.
But that, he just...
And he was just doing this, right?
Yeah. Like,
okay,
what is he doing? And then he would also, because Hank, he's very quiet. It's usually Budget that does most of the talking. But Hank is able to talk to Kajo and ask him, you know, and get so many answers out of him. And he would say that when he was very young, he would draw on any paper he would find, down to the margins of dictionaries.
Oh, wow.
He would just draw
any open space, right? Yeah, you know, or like, you know, there's like little spaces between on the edges of the pages of books and stuff. That would just all be filled up with like, you know, little doodles and drawings and stuff.
Oh wow! So, do either of you have a photo of this 9-panel Trese portrait by chance?
You know, yes, I'll try to look for it. It might be in my files.
If you could send me, just snap a picture, I could potentially edit it in and then people could see it, but...
I will look for it in my files.
Okay. Another thing, can I just add? that one of the little, how'd I call it? I call that an Easter egg? Or there's like a hidden thing.
Yeah, where, Easter egg.
Or a hidden Mickey, or I'm not sure what it's called, but like he didn't tell anybody this. And if you're not really going to put them together, you would never figure this out. But when he did the Trese books, especially I think the second or the third, like if you put all the covers, if you put all the books together, it is one
big picture. Oh, no kidding.
Yeah.
I think the first six, yeah.
Check out your copies. I don't know if it's, you know, he did it for one particular reissue or reprinting.
Right.
And then parang he just kept doing it after that. But he didn't tell anybody. So it's a little.
Yeah, we all found out a little bit later.
Yeah.
Well, it was in the promo I did for this episode. If you look at my Instagram,
kicked
off Facebook currently, but
again.
But if you look at my Instagram, you'll see like what it looks like when you put it all together. Yeah.
Yep.
So let's talk for a minute about the creators, and then we'll talk about how you guys know them. So it's Budget Tan is the writer, correct?
Yep.
And then say the artist's first name again.
Kajo.
Okay. And
Kajo. Yep.
Kajo Baldissimo?
Yes.
Baldissimo.
Yes.
Got it.
Yep. See, it's like, I guess it's English, which is my native language. I have trouble pronouncing stuff in other languages. I can just like fumble into pronouncing things somehow. So I found Budget. I believe it's Budget's blog. This is Friday, May 27th, 2011. He has a post, The Real Hank D. Bartender. And it opens with a picture of you with Budget and Kaijo. And it goes into how he met Karen, the band scene at the time, and then how they met you. We'll get back to that. But so talk, you guys, I don't want to, you know, tell your story. Talk about how you met one another, how you met these guys, how this whole thing happened.
Yeah, well, I met Karen because she's my cousin.
That's
by
right.
By the way, Shawn, I'm so proud that you've done all this research, but
sorry about that.
Continue.
And then, yes. And I met, and through Karen, I met these guys, right? There was a club back then called Club Dread, and she took them to that club. It was a music, independent bands and young up-and-coming bands.
And you were playing, right? Electric Kool-Aid?
One of my bands was playing. No, not yet. Not, I wasn't in Electric Kool-Aid yet. That came about maybe 10 years later. Okay. But my very first, I wouldn't say very first band, but it started off as my college band and got a little Colored Red. You may Google them. They're still playing. I'm not with them anymore, but yeah. But, you know, they would come. They would show up. Very quiet, very nerdy, sort of very geeky. I mean, I was geeky and nerdy, but if you looked at me, it's like, oh no, he's in a band. I had long hair, you know, ripped up jeans. I didn't look like your typical nerd, whatever that means. I'm not sure what a typical, but I mean, they were like, you know, short haircuts and, you know, they looked like nice guys.
Then right.
They weren't like Coldplay bad, were they?
Sorry, they weren't Coldplay.
Coldplay
bad?
No.
No, they okay. were playing. I think a big influence was 10,000 Maniacs.
Okay.
Wow, Natalie anyway, Merchant, huh?
They came and then so I met them and then they did mention that we're doing this thing where it's independent Filipino comics. As soon as they said comics, I was like, whoa. Well, they also said independent, which also made me go, whoa, right? And then so-
Talk about Budget and-
Budget and Kajo, yes, how I met them. So, and they were part of a group called Alamat, a bunch of like independent, and they were all young, right? They were all like around college age, maybe just a little bit out of college possibly. And they all just like, you know, want to do comics. So what they would do is they would do the comics and then, what was the word? They do Xerox copies.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. So they make it like total grassroots.
Yeah, like ash camp. And then they'd staple the middle. So really very, very, you know, and that's how they started. They were saying like, you know, we're in so much, we need some help, right? We need some help. Financially could, you know, if anybody wants to, you know, invest.
They were going to incorporate.
Yeah. So
that they could get own the name and publish.
So I said, all right, if I can't draw and I can't write, this is my way in, man. This is the only way I'm going to get into comics. So I gave them an amount of like, I think, yeah, I gave them a little bit and then they said, oh, cool. You know, and then that helped them do their thing. And mm-hmm. And then I came, you know, I would hang out in the circle because like, you know, and then and we were friends after that, like, you know, and then a few years later on, a little bit after Electric Kool-Aid,
mm-hmm.
my other band, I owned a bar, or I was partners with some friends, and I owned a bar in Malate. That's a very cool nightlife district in
Manila.
This is the Verve room you're talking about, right?
Wow. Yeah,
exactly. Oh my gosh, Shawn, cheers, buddy.
Hey, cheers,
you know,
man.
Exactly. He knows exactly what I'm talking about. This is so cool.
Anyway, this is just Budget's blog. I mean, basically that told everything. So
they would hang out there. We had known each other for quite some time now. And they would hang out there. But they would just sit, you know, they would nurse one beer, two beers overnight. And they would just like sit and watch and listen. And you know, because it was the 90s. So raves had just come to Manila.
Okay.
Right? Ecstasy had just hit the, you know, it was like, and everybody's just coming out in outfit. It's like, you know, when Ecstasy hit Manila, I think everybody, like, you know, people would walk in with like red hair and then, and you know, and like crazy outfits, like, I mean, this was like before I even heard of the term cosplay. And I do remember there was one, it wasn't even Halloween. This girl walked in and she was dressed exactly like Baby Spice. Right? It was the 90s. You know, we're all like, and she was talking like she was Baby Spice. And, you know, I think she might have been an English. I mean, she wasn't the real Baby Spice, but.
I thought that's where you were going.
An English lady,
Spice,
right?
Is hot.
Yeah. So anyway, that's just an example. So I mean, these are the kind of like things that these two guys are just like, they were like checking out. I mean, we would talk at the bar and whatnot. So yeah, I mean, that's pretty much in a nutshell. Like sometimes we'd hang out, have coffee, but more often than not, we would see each other at my bar, which is based on the Diabolical, which actually makes an appearance in the comic books a lot.
Right, which is where. Yeah, so the Diabolical in the comic is based on
the Verve Room.
The Verve Room, and you are in the comic the bartender. So you are kind of like almost this, in a way. Well, it's okay. So it seems to me that Trese and her boys, the Kambal, like, is this, like they're kind of like where they go. This is their spot. Like it seems like you guys have some kind of an understanding where like she's there kind of watching things. Like, it seems like it's kind of a crossroads for various different kinds of, not just people, but these other entities that are all over the place. Right.
It's a weird mix. How would I say? Okay. Diabolical, the club, number one, it's owned by Trese. It's been in her family for generations. It doesn't say so in the books, but I feel like, I mean,
what I got from it saying it.
That's cool. I mean, that's pretty much it. But there's also some stuff there that like I don't know how much of it comes from like just my brain and how much of it comes from like talking to Kajo and Budget a lot, right? Because sometimes like we'll hang out, we'll have coffee, and we'll just talk. Sometimes we'll talk comics, we'll talk other stuff, and sometimes we'll talk about me, which is weird, But so anyway, the Diabolical has been owned by the Trese family for generations. But, and you are right, there, it is also a, sort of like a, how would I call it? Like a neutral zone. Right?
Yes, so, there you go. That's exactly what I was looking for, right? Hank. That's so, like, exactly what I was looking for.
You could be like a supernatural creature. You could be a fairy. Or a monster, right? And no violence is allowed. No, you know, sort of like, right. But also, it is also like a headquarters, right? I'm gonna loosely use the term bat cave. It's like a bat cave, right?
That's kind of how it seemed. Definitely.
There you go.
That's cool. That's very cool. And I love the idea of a public bat cave. Because it's the exact, if it's still a bat cave, but it's, I don't know, there's just something more thrilling about that. Probably just because the bat cave has been the bat cave forever. Nothing against the bat cave, it's still cool, right? But you see the giant penny, you see the giant Tyrannosaurus Rex statue, and it's like, oh my God. But especially when Kelly Jones draws the bat cave, but that, I digress. It has that feel where she's standing up, you know, I think it's the fourth episode. Where she's standing up, and you know, I think the Cabal, her boys are down at the bar, and you're there, and then she's kind of looking over everything, and that's when there's this like incident in, yes. I guess it's like kind of the back area of the bar, which is obviously like you're not supposed to do that there, right? So somebody is, there's a lot of talk in the book also of rules, right? So in several of the stories, it's like, you know, the supernatural entities, like something happens and then she goes to investigate it. And it's like, we know what the rules are. We wouldn't break them. Or you know what the rules are, you know, you can't break it. So it seems like she's kind of always lording over everything from this place.
Not necessarily lording over it. I feel like that's more Hank's job.
Okay.
But I know what you're saying. But when she is there, of course, I mean, you know, she owns the place and she's like, hey,
yeah,
so I'm gonna kick your ass, you know, if you fuck around, I'm gonna kick your ass.
I just realized we should probably talk about what this book is about, because we all know, and like anybody watching this is like, what the fuck are they talking, like what is this? So I'll try to add the trailer to the beginning of the episode when I edit it,
okay,
and so people can get a sense. But what I saw somebody recently, I feel like there was a comparison that was like something and, oh, what the hell was it? Like something.
Jessica Jones, X-Files.
Yeah, it was something like that. Where I was,
that
like,
might have been me that said that.
What do you, one of you guys.
Jessica Karen, Jones, Buffy, X-Files.
Karen, give us like a I don't know, a elevator pitch.
A filmmaker pitch. Oh my gosh. Supernatural sleuth investigates supernatural crime in Metro Manila. When you do, that's a bit long for a pitch, but when you watch the trailer, you'll see people living in Metro Manila or the Philippines going, oh my God, that's really, it really captures, I think Hank, you have the same feedback. That, yes. It really captures the MRT, it really captures our streets, and it is another avenue to play with and reintroduce characters from Philippine mythology into pop culture. And Netflix has been really good with the promotions. I mean, they've organized, they've come out with a trailer, they're setting up junkets, they're doing a live stream concert. They're really pushing it. And it's they even had Eleven, Millie Bobby Brown, talk about the different Philippine mythological creatures.
Really?
In a little promotional clip. Yes.
Hang on.
Yeah.
Can you send me a link or tell me where I can find that?
Sure, I think she talks about the manananggal, tikbalang. It's just a few minutes, but she's so cute.
That's what I was gonna say. She's so cute.
Discusses each one, and
I'm a Stranger Things fan.
So,
yeah, me too.
Yeah, so in the trailer, you'll get to see a few of those. And I do like the trailer, although Hank doesn't look like Hank.
I guess it's been a couple days since I watched the trailer, and so obviously now looking at you, sir, I guess I could see that. But also everything is slightly changed, because the first thing you encounter in the book, I think, is also one of the first things in the trailer, and that's the hold on. I love the fact that the way the trade is set up for you know, potential readers, there's, I think it's six stories, and they're probably between what, like 10 and 12 pages each, and it's an incident. It starts with the police at an incident, and then they call her in, and it's like they've done their, you know, immediate forensics, and the chief will be like, okay, give me a minute, guys. And then Trese comes in, and he knows she can do things to get a bigger picture story. And the first one is the creature that pops out of the manhole.
Uno.
Yes. And so decidedly different looking in the comic and the Netflix show. I get it. Like they kind of accentuate certain features so it looks very otherworldly. And, you know, I mean, it's animation, so I understand that. It's perhaps more, I mean, not that it's not thrilling in the book, but I guess that's the word I would use. It's a little bit more sensationalistic, I guess, less subtle.
Although
I love that page where it pops out. That's my favorite page in the book.
What I know of Nuno, Nuno are not urban. It's funny. It's an urban Nuno underneath the manhole. Usually they're...
I think that the whole...
They're the whole forest. The
story is like, he's a Nuno that moved from the country into the city. Right? And like the
why would a Nuno want to move to the city?
So Uno is probably not a creation of the creators of Trese.
No, it's folklore. Like
an urban legend.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So
definitely, yes.
The format of the book, what I one of the things I was going to add is, so behind each of these six stories,
four,
there's several pages that tell you in like prose. It's almost like a file card. I think of it as like the file cards that were on the back of some of the toys that I grew up with. Yeah. But it's like, so, you know, and it's all from the journal of what I'm assuming is Trese's father, who everybody constantly mentioned. She inherited all of her gift and everything from. So it'll be from the journal of Professor Alexander Trese. And so Nuno Sapunso. And then it goes into what this creature is. And it's lifted directly from folklore in the Philippines. And so, like Karen said, it's reintroducing this stuff that maybe, and let's face it, guys, this is so awesome, because number one, I think the reason why Netflix is really pumping this, like what Karen was saying, is because Castlevania just ended. And I get the feeling that maybe they're positioning this to kind of pick up where that left off as like a flagship original animation, because it's a very similar thing where it's like, it's taking folklore, stuff that people have heard of for years, and kind of re-spinning it in a different way, right? And it's the perfect time to do it, because there's so much like call for horror based on this kind of stuff, right?
It's
exciting to see this happening. And like for these guys that you're talking about, they started out stapling their own fucking comics together and borrowing money to like incorporate. And this, I mean, next week, this is dropping on Netflix. That's so, I mean, Jesus, that's a fucking success story. That's amazing.
Yes. Although it took a long time.
16 years? No.
More. Well, Alamat got for
Trese,
together.
For Trese. I'm talking about Trese.
Trese. Yeah,
but Trese did start that way. Like they would, you know, they would do photocopies and do that. Are they called ash cans? Is that what they're called?
Uh-oh, nawala si Mike.
I'm here. I'm back.
Yeah, I don't know if they're called ash cans, but yes, I guess early 2000s. So I would say.
Yeah, around 2004, 2005, I feel.
Yeah, so 15 years.
Oh, fuck, don't say that shit.
16.
No, don't make it even worse, Hank. Come on.
No, we're talking about comic books. We're talking about how old the comic books are.
No, I know, but still, when you like,
I'm a little over 16. I'm legal to drink.
So, and then they actually
Age of Content.
And they have very, I think part of the success can be owed to the fans. They have like such an active and engaged fan base, and there's a fan page, and there's fan fiction, and there's slash fiction, there's erotic fiction already.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, wow. Hank was part of a broadcast where they spent a good chunk of time reading the Trese slash fiction.
Some fan fiction, yeah.
Wait, so Hank, so there's erotic slash fiction for your character out there?
No, not yet. Not yet. It was other characters.
He's working on it.
I'm not working on it. I think somebody else might be working on it.
I'm working on it.
Mike Wellman is doing something. He's using a pen name, I'm sure. But
Wellman.
But it's crazy. I mean, I love the fans. Like they would come up to me like, so they based this character on you. Could you sign my book? You know, I mean, fans would come up to me like that, or are you the real?
So Mike, you met Hank when you went over. So you were there in early 2020, right before the pandemic. I remember because I saw you right before you went. I saw you right after.
Well, I met Karen at San Diego Comic Con.
Well, I knew that, but I'm saying, so when was the first? Did you meet Hank the first time you were in the Philippines?
Actually, the first time I met Mike, I had come to LA.
Oh, okay. Yeah, oh, there you go.
He
okay.
was here.
And I came in at a late flight, maybe 10 or 11 p.m., right? Mike said like, okay, you know, I was with Karen. And Mike's like, hey, cool, all right. You know what, I'm going to go over and say hello to you guys at your hotel. And Mike was so sweet. He brought us food, right? Karen wasn't that hungry, but I was famished. I really appreciated those. What was that? It was Japanese, like sushi rolls or something.
I don't even remember.
But, you know, okay. I just went through them like that. Like I'm just like,
oh, cool.
Yeah, no, I remember. So that was in LA. And then, although Mike had come to Manila for the convention.
I've been there twice.
Yeah, for the convention, the very first time. But that was all work. That was all work, no play. It was like he had Mike Wellman, the machine. I mean, I think he did like one. You just came from San Diego, right? And then a week later,
after, yeah.
Crazy.
I remember that.
Like back, time zones, you know. Oh my God,
like, but he was who just does like, that, right? Who finishes San Mike Diego Wellman. Comic Con
and the flies one and only
Mike shower Wellman that takes off for that?
I'm gonna guess he did not take a shower. I'm just kidding, Mike.
Yeah, I might not have taken a shower. But so, yeah,
okay.
Let
so,
them continue praising me.
Karen, tell us. So on Budget's blog, he talks about how when he met you in the mid '90s, I love. He says, and this is again for the audience. This is the writer of Trese. He says, you were their guide and gate pass into the wonderful world of Pinoy rock bands. She was our Alice and Mad Hatter rolled into one. And so talk about like your involvement with these guys and the project. And I know you write the introduction to volume 2, which is coming out, or is it out?
Not yet out. I don't know when volume.
Okay, it's forthcoming.
They should have that because the series is coming out and people are going to want to read it.
Yeah.
But yes, I was writing a column called On the Verge, in the 90s, and it was all about pop culture, and I was working in advertising, but I loved hanging out at the rock clubs. I mean, these tiny little holes in the wall where a new crop of Philippine rock bands were just like, they were emerging, and it was like such a great scene. And so many colorful characters, so many funny characters. And I got into that. Then while I was writing the column, budget, like, you know, back in the day, you would write snail mail to the columnist or to the writer. And he goes like, hey, I read your column. I do comics and we are, you know, doing an exhibit of comic art. And we're going to, you know, have our, it's like, oh my gosh, there's a local group that has comics. And at that time I was like so into Neil Gaiman. So we'd talk a lot about him and about his work. And yeah, that's why, and he also loved the X-Files. And, you know, I had a good friend, my best friend who would, you know, love X-Files. So we would all hang out, watch X-Files. And yeah, we continued to like just hang out with, again, these very nerdy, quiet comic creators, and then these like crazy, you know, crazy rock musicians. And yeah, like Hank said, they would just observe and take it in. And they actually had a comic called Batch 72, which is about, what's that, like a government experiment. And suddenly there's a rock band with superpowers.
Ooh.
Something like that.
Don't
that was like one of the budget's pre-Trese works.
Yeah, that's really difficult to find. That's one of those, like, you know, photocopies and just staple down the middle jobs. Yeah.
So, yeah. And, you know, I was always worried, like, are they going to be, you know, are they going to be okay? Are they going to have fun? But they did. They I have so many, like, very funny stories about Budget and his brother. And of course, we would also hang out in, Will's Portacho had a studio there called Wildfire.
Yes.
Oh my God. Was it Wildfire?
I think that's right. That was the 90s.
Yeah. So we would hang out there. And that's also where I met Jerry Alangilan for the first time. And
Brian Haverlin was there, right?
I'm not sure if he was, maybe. So there was just a nice creative boom going on at the time. I don't know if, I mean, that's sort of, it waned, no, Hank? Like, yes, we don't see it just waned, but I think
it was like, yeah, I think in a weird way, I mean, I think like the 90s was a good time for comics and even music, right?
Yeah, but the thing is, like,
Philippines, well, maybe probably everywhere.
Everywhere. Yeah. Because it was the last, it was before everything got gobbled by corporate, and then, you know, that, like, I don't know.
And then the internet as well, right?
Things
changed. I feel like the world changed after the internet.
Yeah, even if that happened though, Hank, the comics kind of, it grew. They have tiny comic conventions called Comic Con and Comic Cat.
Our little culture, yeah.
Yeah, so it's a vibrant, to be a vibrant little scene. And Mike has met some of the creators. And you know, there's a lot of work and that's still being published, and the independent scene is, you know, it's thriving. I don't know about the pandemic, you know, but I would see it as a time for creators to create. And I think there's just so much inspiration. Plus, it's such a boost to see this title land on Netflix. It's quite inspiring, and it just shows that there's, you know, there's a market for just something new, something different. You know, and something coming out of Asia at a time when I don't really know exactly what it's totally like to be Asian in the US, but right now there's such a good focus on Asian voices. Like, you know, they're more outspoken now. Mm-hmm. And it's just nice to have this, you know, it's nice to have this. You're just hearing so many different voices and picking up things from the culture.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. I don't know if I'm making sense, but it's
yeah.
It's,
no, as an Asian and as a Filipino, I know what you're saying, Karen. Of course, right? Because it is nice to hear the Filipino, you know, voice or something, or I don't know what the right word, representation. I know, and to see it on Netflix, you're sort of like, hey, you know, first time. It's a big deal. And it's animation and we know where the roots and the seeds came from. I mean, it's like Pinoy independent comic books on Netflix. Yes, it took us 16 years, but fuck, we're here, right? Damn.
We're here, but I mean, also, so like going back to that thing where like it's the folklore and whatnot, it's like one of the things about humanity that people forget because we get so like, Americans are Americans, and you know, you get what people do either on purpose or without even realizing it, because everybody does it to some degree. Some people do it, you know, very like a lot, and that's like they define themselves by I'm not this, I'm not this, I'm not this, right? So it's one of the things like very, very ignorant people use that to say I'm this and I don't like this and I don't like this and I don't like this. But other people, you know, like I feel like probably everybody in the world, to some degree, you have to kind of build the scaffolding of who you are based on certain experiences, and your experiences start first and foremost where you're from, right? So, but the wonderful thing about humans and the world is that this shit is, it's the collective unconscious. It's why I believe in those things, because yeah, like you can take the image of Satan and it, they might not call it Satan, but there's something similar, or a vampire, or a werewolf, or a genie, right, or a ghost, or whatever, right? So the amazing thing now is that you can say, like Netflix is going to give us here in the US, in a very big way, we're going to be able to say, I know what a ghost is, or I know what a fairy is, or a whatever, but I don't know what do they call it in the Philippines? And when, how does that differ? And you can look at it and be like, it's, right. I feel like it's the same thing. And that's, that to me, if anything, I mean, I don't want to tangent into like whether or not we believe in the supernatural, but it's one of the things that makes me believe in kind of these bigger concepts as being more than just, you know, fodder for fairy tales and stories, is that like it, you can be in, you know, multiple people in different countries that have never spoken to one another have shared similar experiences. So obviously there's something there, right?
Right. There's some kind of bogeyman. There's just this unknown, and fear is universal. And I guess within different communities and in different cultures, the fears that we have take on different forms.
But not that different.
Not that different. I mean, like, I think, like the tikbalang, right? That's a horse.
Oh,
and then there's the centaur.
And the human body.
The centaur is But the centaur, the tikbalang, it's like a
reverse centaur.
Yes,
it's the head. Oh, man,
it's like a human, but then with a horse
body.
Well, it's like an upright. I don't know. Yeah. Bojack Horseman.
The scene, actually, the scene where
that's what a tikbalang is. It's Bojack Horseman.
But creepier.
The scene where she sees that, and it's like, you know, she's racing him, and then all of a sudden, it's like the splash page. Hopefully I can edit this in, but where it's just standing in front of her. Oh my God, it's so cool. It's so cool. And she's just talking to it.
Yeah, and then there's a very common one called the White Lady. And Hank used to live near the street where they would spot this White Lady, and supposed to be, I don't know, she's supposed to be somebody who's dead long ago and just trying to flag cabs.
So this is crazy. I'm actually glad you brought this up. I forgot about this one. And this is on where I'm from on the south side of Chicago. There's an area, it's the suburbs there are largely, it was once all forest preserved. There's an area called Willow Springs, and it borders on this other area of justice. And there's a ballroom that's been there forever. It's just a bar now, if it's even still there. But there's been stories about this. There it's Resurrection Mary. And I think there's another name for it. But yeah, it's like this girl that supposedly died, you know, in I forget if it was a car accident or somebody killed her, whatever it is. But it's local, you know, urban legend. And it's like somebody will meet her at the ballroom, dance with her all night, go to drive her home. And then when they get to her house, she's not in the car anymore. And so I'm reading Trese and I'm like, holy shit. I thought this was something, you know what I mean? Like vampires, yeah, it's universal. Yeah. But this was something I thought was specific to the fucking south side of Chicago. And here it is in the Philippines. So cool. So fucking cool.
Wow.
Yeah I don't know. Okay, in the trailer, Trese tells Hank, like, Hank, the creature we're looking for is a Tiyanak. I don't know if... What do you call that? Evil baby?
Demon baby? Demon child?
Demon baby.
It's like a demon that takes, well, the basic body is like
a baby.
Like a fetus or like a baby, a newborn baby, but like, you know, demon fangs.
Yeah, yes.
Like oh, demon, cool. Demon teeth and like little claws.
But it's a little baby.
And yeah, just
creepy. So that's not in the first volume. Yeah. So that's got to be in one of the subsequent ones, right? Oh, that's creepy.
Should be. Yeah.
And then I mean, it also deals with urban legends, and I guess every town or place has its urban legend. Like in upcoming issues of Trese.
Actually, it's a mix of like urban legends, like the White Lady is an urban legend more than Philippine folklore. And then you have things like the Tikbalang and the Tiyanak.
And the Nuno.
Those are like actually like from old, you know, old folklore.
Manananggal. Yeah. Yes. And yeah, urban legend like the snake in Robinson's.
The White Lady, So it's a nice mix of like old and I guess urban would be like that some of the newer
story,
so to speak.
Yeah, I don't know if they're going to incorporate this in the TV shows, but they have not only does Budget borrow the bartender, he also borrows from politics.
Everywhere.
Show business and sports. Stuff
in Philippine culture. Yeah. I mean you know, like I guess if there was like a, for example, if there's a scandal, a sports scandal, right? Like an NFL player
who's the boxer over
goes
there
to jail, right? Yeah, something like that. Yeah, we have one, and actually there's one in
Pacquiao.
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
I think that what's the title of that one? Fight of the Night or something?
Yeah, something.
I haven't read that one, but I know.
Minus points. We should know this.
I should read. I haven't read my Trese comics in a while.
But Pacquiao is an asshole. We all can agree.
Well, you know what? As a politician, I'm not a big fan of his work, right? As a boxer, I love him. I wish
separate
he just
separate the man boxer from his art. Right?
Yeah, right, right.
Yeah, exactly, right. I mean, he's a great. Like, I don't know, I'm trying to think of somebody. Well, Jesse the Bod Ventura.
Yeah, there you go. And then we blur the lines.
But he was an okay politician, wasn't he? Did he not, was he okay or not okay? I'm not
you know,
sure.
As a governor, he was kind of a dick.
He was on
and
the
when
money
I was
with
married,
a lot of shit, though.
I got to meet him because he was doing a toy drive with Tom Arnold, you know, Tom Arnold from
of course.
He was Roseanne's ex-husband.
True Lies.
And Tom Arnold was obviously like coked up and sweating like a maniac. And so my ex-wife, Carol, we did a toy drive at her place she was working at. And I got to meet Arnold Schwarzenegger. And while he was governor, I was like, oh, you know, I miss seeing you on the big screen. Is what I said, and he just looked at me. He's like, "Eh," because I think he took it like, "I don't like your politics." You know, I mean, I look like a hippie.
Well,
He's like, eh.
Could have been worse. She could have said, hasta la vista.
Yeah, right. Your right. luggage.
And then you knew you're in trouble now.
Stick around, Bennett. Okay, so.
Hasta la vista, well, man.
I got a question for Hank.
Yes, sir.
What is the neon orange cocktail that Budget refers to in his blog? Because apparently there is a cocktail. There's a story about you serving Bill Pullman.
Yes, but the cocktail was not orange. The cocktail was not orange. It was not neon.
You're right.
Did I mention it was the 90s and raves and shit?
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
Yeah, could have been the lights, could have been the drugs, could have been both. Budget does not do drugs.
You're going on record. It's because so Budget's exact words, and I'm not saying he's right. I'm just saying so you know where I'm getting this from. On this blog, says, Hank became the bartender of the Verve Room in Malate. We always got a free welcome drink from Hank. He never told us what was in that neon orange concoction, but it always got us started on the right foot. That's why I said neon orange. So, but it was just neon.
No problem. Yeah, I can't remember if it's neon orange, but I do remember because, and this is true, right? I mean, when I was, and I did own the bar as well, I always felt like, when I saw them come in, I always felt like these guys don't get out much.
You're trying to give them a boost. You're trying to give them a social boost,
Yep, I want to make sure they have a good time, right?
Yeah.
I don't go out much, but when they do, I want to give them a good time. And because it was like a mix of like, you know, it was sort of like two different worlds I was in. It was like, okay, so I was a musician. I was always out at night, and then I opened a bar of my own. And then there's the sort of like the a little more introverted side that likes the books.
Mm-hmm.
That you know, I would read Dune or Lord of the Rings, and I would get into comic books. So when I would see them, you know, it's sort of like a crossover.
That's a good way to say it.
But they're in my bar. Come over here. First round's on me. Sit here. You know, let's talk. Let's hang out for a little bit. You know, so it was sort of like a little bit of that. And I sort of like wanted to introduce them to my other friends from the clubs and whatnot. And you know, basically find more people to be like me, sort of. Or you know, because like I said, I'm a mix of this and that. So like if from one side, if I can
bring people, you wish you could have gone to that bar, Shawn.
Bring them together. Yeah. There'd be more people like me. It'd be easier to talk to, you know.
It makes perfect sense. In fact, Hank, I mean, I feel that you're describing me to some degree, but I'll tell you the best example of what you're talking about that I know of, the man that pulls it off most successfully is Mike Wellman.
Holy shit, yes.
He's the best example. He's just exactly that. He's like the guy that knows all this obscure, like Beta Ray Bill, Star-Lord shit from way before it was fucking cool. And it's just here. But then also, he's the most social dude in the room. So, I mean, I've seen him walk into a room of like a couple hundred people and just like everybody stops and eyes on Mike.
Effortless.
Effortless. Yeah.
I mean, you guys don't make me cry.
Yeah, I mean, here we go. This is the Mike Wellman Admiration Society right here. I mean, I've seen you do it, right? And you do it also with music and, you know, and stuff.
Shit, if they've seen you do it, you do it in the Philippines, you know? I mean, you go to some other country and you just do the same thing, but that's nothing less than what I would expect.
That is true. I love it. He was in the Philippines possibly less than 24 hours the first time. No, the first time when he did APCC. Yes. Coming from... Yeah. There you go, Mike.
What was that?
No, I got some shit I want to talk about.
Talk about it. What do you got?
All right. So, you know, I was born in America. Grew up in America. I'm 47 years old.
John Cougar heart attack?
No, I'm just kidding. Born in the USA. But my second home is the Philippines. And like, I've discovered so many amazing friends and culture. So Sean,
shout out to Jay Ignacio.
What's that?
Jay Ignacio.
Shout out to Jay Ignacio.
Yeah, Jay Ignacio and Alex Nino. A beautiful book about wine and maybe why you shouldn't drink so much. I don't know. But Jay Ignacio, I got a whole bag of really cool stuff. Paulo
Eras.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Secret HQ.
Strange Natives. I think he just wrote it, right? He didn't draw it. But it's incredible. I mean, this is all stuff I can't sell.
Well, it's yours, mine, right? But... So I'm assuming this is what you brought back. Oh, wow. Oh, wow.
Rod Espinosa.
Oh, Rod Espinosa. I'm not
sure. You know Rod now?
Dude, I met Rod through you.
Yeah, Rod is amazing.
Mike Wellman introduced me to a Filipino comic book maker.
I expect no less.
Well, what's funny was I came back my first trip to the Philippines.
Right?
And I'm a big cheese lover. And so, like, I kept trying to get, like, a chili cheese dog or whatever, like, over there. And the cheese was never good. So, like, I was like, I had a great time in the Philippines, but they don't know how to make cheese. And
We are not known for our cheese.
We're not a cheese.
We're not known for our cheese.
Well, Rod's like, well, let me take you to the Spiral Cafe so you can find out. And so we went and Rod, you know, we talk a lot on Facebook and stuff. So we went Spiral Cafe together, me, Rod, Jay, DJ Paste, who's an amazing, yes. I don't know if you call it graffiti, but like he does amazing, whatever, art. Graffiti. Yeah.
Graffiti type art.
Street artist. Yeah. And so we all went to Spiral Cafe. It's like $55, all you can eat. They bring you lobster. You can go into the cheese room. I've never eaten so much in my life. I like my body was like, but Rod was right. Like there are some people in the Philippines who know how to make cheese. Not many, but. He took me to the places it did. I mean, honestly, like I love that country. I know that their politics are about, well, they're actually worse than ours are now right now. But, you know, back when Trump was president, like they're about as bad as ours were.
Wow, that's awesome.
Duterte is a piece of shit. Like, let's just put it there. But the people are amazing. Like, and the way we were treated was just, I've never been treated with such respect and adoration, you know. And, you know, I can't wait to go back. I'm ready, you know. I'm down. Like, let me know, you know.
That's awesome. So.
That's nice. I mean, that's really what life is about. It's not about taking opportunity from one another. It's not about any of that. It's about, you know, loving each other the best we can.
Shared experience, right? And I mean, exactly. And that's what's so beautiful about this dropping on June 11th, Trese, is that it's going to open the door to this shared experience. And I think it's going to be huge. I really like, I've watched the trailer countless times. I've recommended it to people who I know who loved Castlevania, who are like anime or who just like horror or, you know, met like supernatural shit. And everybody's like, oh my God, you know? So I don't know, man. I think it is going to be huge.
It's going to be cool.
So, okay, yeah. Guys, we're going to wrap it, but just, Give me a close. What do you guys want to say in closing? I'll go one at a time through the three of you. So Karen, what do you want to say in closing?
Well, I actually haven't seen Trese, but I'm very excited, and I'm inviting everybody to check it out. You're going to see, I guess we're all going to see for the first time in this format, creatures from, I mean, of course we've all seen, it's just a, like I said, it's a reintroduction. And I hope that the trailer delivers on its promise. It's quite exciting.
Yeah.
And there's a part of me that hopes there's going to be a live action of this. Wow.
That would be awesome.
I actually would have wanted a live action ahead of the anime, but I, you know, I don't call these things, but yes, I'm excited. It arrives the day before Independence Day. Philippine Independence Day is June 12th, but what are we independent from? That's another question. But and thanks for having us. Thanks for having me and Hank, and allowing us to share a little bit of the history of our friendship with the creators and their foray into the Manila, the somewhat decadent Manila of the 90s, which, you know, it's gone now. I mean,
well, the decadence of the 90s is gone everywhere, I feel like, so.
Yeah, it's not the same, but I think, I mean, a lot of the seeds of this came from that scene.
That's cool. That's very cool.
Especially with that bar.
Hank, closing thoughts?
Yeah. Please check out Trese on Netflix. It's dropping on June 11, day before Philippine Independence Day. Also support Filipino comics. Actually, you know what? Just support
all comics.
Yeah,
support comics. Like, you know, it's a pandemic, and you know,
right?
Everybody needs it. And without our art, you know, yes, our movies, our comic books, how are we gonna get through shit like this?
Yeah,
right?
Agreed.
I mean, this is the stuff that you're like, I'm stuck at home, I can't go anywhere, but I got my comic books, right? Yep. That shit's gonna get you through.
Yeah, thanks to Mike who delivered. You delivered to people who needed their comics over the pandemic.
Yeah. I mean, he literally fucking delivers comics. He literally delivers. Yeah, he's like the Knight Rider of comics.
Michael Knight.
There you go. Mike, closing thoughts.
Well, you know, from my perspective, I really think it's important and good to get out there in the world and explore and find new cultures and you know, new ideas. And that's what happened when I went to the Philippines. Like, I've known about Trese for like 4 or 5 years, you know. I'm not like being like the braggy hipster guy.
No. That's you don't sound like you are at all.
Yeah, I'm just saying, like, yeah, there's a lot of good shit out there. Like,
yeah,
there's not a lot of Filipino food that I was attracted to, like balut or whatever. No, but their comics and their culture, yes. You know what balut is?
No.
It's like a half-born chicken egg.
Stop. I got to go eat dinner after this, so stop. I don't want to hear that. That's so freaky.
Duck eggs.
Duck embryo. What?
Oh, no.
Duck eggs.
Duck embryo.
Did I mess that up?
No.
It sounds like you got it right, embryo.
It's a raw yeah, duck egg.
They don't know how to make cheese very well, for the most part. But when it comes to art and comics, they got it down.
Right on.
So, yeah, I mean... yeah, I don't know what the translation there is, but
I don't know if this is entirely possible based on my schedule. So June 11th, when this drops, that is what
Friday.
So right, next Friday. So maybe could we maybe do like a live tweeting thing? I mean, I see the thing with Netflix is like it's just going to drop at midnight on Thursday, right? So I don't know.
Probably, yeah.
it kind of makes it irrelevant, but maybe we could organize something. If you guys are all on, if we're all on social media, we connect, and maybe we could do some kind of a live, like watch along or something, just to do it. I don't care if anybody else
want to do is just watch it, you know?
I'm saying watch it. And then maybe we could go back and, like, you know, almost like a commentary, like we're, you know, even just for an episode, you know, I don't know. I mean,
yeah, maybe for one episode. Yeah.
I like, yeah, we could. That sounds interesting.
So I'll throw that out in the thread that we have going on Messenger. And if it happens, it happens. If not, no big deal. But I really, you two, I love. I mean, I love him anyway, but I love you two as well. Like, you guys.
Love him anyway.
You guys are anyway. Great. And I thank you both for being on. And
thank you.
Yeah.
And we miss the whole scene over there.
So do we.
And when it's possible, I would like love to go back. And
yeah,
I miss LA. I was talking to Beth this morning.
Oh wow,
Beth,
how's she doing?
They called me at 3 a.m.
What?
They're doing all right. They're doing all right. They're in good spirits as usual. But yeah, no, I really miss LA. And
well, when you guys come back,
I don't miss LA as much as I miss my friends in LA.
We'll miss you too, Hank.
We'll have a big fucking party when you guys come back. When all this,
yeah, you know. Definitely, yeah. I'm totally vaccinated, so
party. I'm there.
Nice. Okay, guys, let's sign off. So, just for Drinking with Comics,
everybody
out there, check out Trese and Mike and I will be back next week with a bunch of other, you know.
Yeah, we'll talk about new comics.
Maybe. Yeah, talk about new comics. But Karen and Hank, thank you guys. And
thank you so
thanks
much
for coming
Sean.
On, guys.
All my love.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you.
We love you. I love you, Hank. I love you, Karen.